اللهم إني أفتتح الثناء بحمدك وأنت مسدد للصواب بمنك، وأيقنت أنك أنت أرحم الراحمين في موضع العفو والرحمة وأشد المعاقبين في موضع النكال والنقمة وأعظم المتجبرين في موضع الكبرياء والعظمة. اللهم أذنت لي في دعائك ومسألتي فاسمع يا سميع مدحتي وأجب يا رحيم دعوتي وأقل يا غفور عثرتي. فكم يا إلهي من كربة قد فرجتها وهموم قد كشفتها وعثرة قد أقلتها ورحمة قد نشرتها. وحلقتي بلاء قد فككتها. الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل. وكبره تكبيرا. الحمد لله بجميع محامده كلها على جميع نعمه كلها. الحمد لله الذي لا مضاد له في ملكه ولا منازع له في أمره. الحمد لله الذي لا شريك له في خلقه ولا شبيه له في عظمته. الحمد لله الفاشي في الخلق أمره وحمده، الظاهر بالكرم مجده، الباسط بالجود يده، الذي لا تنقص خزائنه ولا تزيده كثرة العطاء إلا جودا وكرما، إنه هو العزيز الوهاب. اللهم إني أسألك قليلا من كثير مع حاجة بي إليه عظيمة وغناك عنه قديم، وهو عندي كثير وهو عليك سهل يسير. اللهم إن عفوك عن ذنبي وتجاوزك عن خطيئتي وصفحك عن ظلمي وسترك على قبيح عملي وحلمك عن كثير جرمي عندما كان من خطئي وعمدي، أضمعني في أن أسألك ما لا أستوجبه منك الذي رزقتني من رحمتك وأريتني من قدرتك وعرفتني من إجابتك. فصرت أدعوك آمنا وأسألك مستأنسا لا خائفا ولا وجلا، مدلا عليك فيما قصدت فيه إليك. ف فإن أبطأ عني اعتبت بجهلي عليك ولعل الذي أبطأ عني هو خير لي لعلمك بعاقبة الأمور فلم أر مولا كريما أصبر على عبد لئيم منك علي يا رب إنك تدعوني فأولي عنك وتتحبب إلي فأتبغض إليك وتتودد إلي فلا أقبل منك كأن لي التطول عليك فلم يمنعك ذلك من الرحمة لي والإحسان إلي والتفضل علي بجودك وكرمك فارحم عبدك الجاهل وجد عليه بفضل إحسانك إنك جواد كريم الحمد لله مالك الملك مجري الفلك مسخر الرياح فالق الإصباح ديان الدين رب العالمين الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمه والحمد لله على عفوه بعد قدرته والحمد لله على طول أناته في غضبه وهو قادر على ما يريد الحمد لله خالق الخلق باسط الرزق فالق الإصباح ذي الجلال والإكرام والفضل والإنعام الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى الحمد لله الذي ليس له منازع يعادله ولا شبيه يشاكله ولا ظهير يعاضده قهر بعزته الأعزاء وتواضع لعظمته العظماء فبلغ بقدرته ما يشاء الحمد لله الذي يجيبني حين أنادي ويستر علي كل عورة وأنا أعصيه ويعظم النعمة علي فلا أجازي فكم من موهبة هنيئة قد أعطاني وعظيمة مخوفة قد كفاني وبهجة مونقة قد أراني فأثني عليه حامدا وأذكره مسبحا الحمد لله الذي لا يهتك حجابه ولا يغلق بابه ولا يرد سائله ولا يخيب آمله الحمد لله الذي يؤمن الخائفين وينجي الصالحين ويرفع المستضعفين ويضع المستكبرين ويهلك ملوكا ويستخلف آخرين والحمد لله قاصم الجبارين مبير الظالمين مدرك الهاربين نكال الظالمين صريخ المستصرخين موضع حاجات الطالبين معتمد المؤمنين الحمد لله الذي من خشيته ترعد السماء وسكا مكانها وترجف الأرض وعمارها وتموج البحار ومن يسبح في غمراتها الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله الذي يخلق ولم يخلق ويرزق ولا يرزق ويطعم ولا يطعم ويميت الأحياء ويحيي الموتى وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وأمينك وصفيك وحبيبك وخيرتك من خلقك وحافظ سرك ومبلغ رسالاتك أفضل وأحسن وأجمل وأكمل وأزكى وأنمى وأطيب وأطهر وأسنى وأكثر ما صليت وباركت وترحمت وتحننت وسلمت على أحد من عبادك وأنبيائك ورسلك وصفوتك وأهل الكرامة عليك من خلقك اللهم وصل على علي أمير المؤمنين وأصي رسول رب العالمين عبدك ووليك وأخي رسولك وحجتك على خلقك وآيتك الكبرى والنبأ العظيم وصل على الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة سيدة نساء العالمين وصل على صبطي الرحمة وإمامي الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة وصل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي حججك على عبادك وأمنائك في بلادك صلاة كثيرة دائمة اللهم وصل على ولي أمرك القائم المؤمن والعدل المنتظر وحفه بملائكتك المقربين وأيده بروح القدس يا رب العالمين اللهم اجعله الداعي إلى كتابك والقائم بدينك استخلفه في الأرض كما استخلفت الذين من قبله مكن له دينه الذي ارتضيته له أبدله من بعد خوفه أمنا يعبدك لا يشرك بك شيئا اللهم أعزه وأعزز به وانصره وانتصر به وانصره نصرا عزيزا وافتح له فتحا يسيرا واجعل له من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا اللهم أظهر به دينك وسنة نبيك حتى لا يستخفي بشيء من الحق مخافة أحد من الخلق اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأهلاه وتذل بها النفاق وأهلاه وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة اللهم ما عرفتنا من الحق فحملنا وما قصرنا عنه فبلغنا اللهم المن به شعثنا واشعب به صدعنا وارتق به فتقنا وكثر به قلتنا وأعزز به ذلتنا وأغن به عائلنا واقض به عن مغرمنا واجبر به فقرنا وسد به خلتنا ويسر به عسرنا وبيض به وجوهنا وفك به أسرنا وأنجح به طلبتنا وأنجز به مواعيدنا واستجب به دعوتنا وأعطنا به سؤلنا وبلغنا به من الدنيا والآخرة آمالنا وأعطنا به فوق رغبتنا يا خير المسؤولين وأوسع المعطين اشف به صدورنا وأذهب به غيظ قلوبنا واهدنا به لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك إنك تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم وانصرنا به على عدوك وعدونا إله الحق آمين اللهم إنا نشكو إليك فقد نبينا صلواتك عليه وآله وغيبته ولينا وكثرة عدونا وقلة عددنا وشدة الفتن بنا وتضاغر الزمان علينا فصل على محمد وآله وأعنا على ذلك بفتح منك تعجله وبضر تكشفه ونصر تعزه وسلطان حق تظهره ورحمة منك تجللنا وعافية منك تلبسنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين صل على محمد وآله الطاهرين.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. Inshallah, we'll start the program with the recitation of the Quran with Haj Aziz. Assalamu alaikum, Haj Aziz. Assalamu alaikum, brother Aziz. Are you?
Alaikum salam, Haji. Salam to you.
Bismillah, brother.
Okay.
Bismillah.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا أوفوا بالعقود أحلت لكم بهيمة الأنعام إلا ما يطلى عليكم غير محل الصيد وأنتم حرم إن الله لا يحكم ما يريد يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تحلوا شعائر الله ولا الشهر الحرام ولا الشهر الحرام ولا الهدي ولا القلائد ولا آمين البيت الحرام الحرام يبتغون فضلا من ربهم ورزوانا وإذا حللتم فاستعدوا وإذا حللتم فاستعدوا قالوا ولا يجرمنكم شنان قوم أن صدوكم أن صدوكم عن المسجد الحرام أن تعتدوا وتعاونوا على البر والتقوى ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان واتقوا الله إن الله شديد العقاب صدق الله العلي العظيم
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد جزاك الله جزيز for the recitation again السلام عليكم brothers and sisters we are in these nights of Laylatul Qadr and commemorating the shahadat of our beloved Imam Ali alayhi salam. Today the shab of his shahadat and in the Laylatul Qadr. And we ask for Allah's forgiveness in these nights for our sins. And Allah curse the killer of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Amen.
And inshallah with this, remember us all in your du'as in this Laylatul Qadr night. And I request Dr. Mehdi Hazari to address the gathering for the Majlis of Shabay Shahadat. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Let us please have a Surah Al-Fatiha for the deceased members of your families, the mu'mineen, the mu'minat, the shuhada, the ulama, and our maraja al-kiram. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. As-sirat al-ladhina an'amta alayhim, ghayr al-maghdubi alayhim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين الأبرار الميامين المظلومين المضطهدين السلام عليك وعلى ابن عمك المظلوم أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين علي بن أبي طالب ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم سادتي وأمن من لجأ والتجأ إليكم يا ليتنا فيا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الذين ينقضون عهد الله من بعد ميثاقه ويقطعون ما أمر الله به أن يوصل ويفسدون في الأرض أولئك هم الخاسرون آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم.
My dear brothers and sisters, on the night of the Shahada of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam, let us reaffirm and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has made us of His Shia. Walhamdulillah alladhi ja'alana min al-mutamassikin bi wilayati sayyidi wa mawlai amir al-mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib. And it is a strange connection that the Ahl al-Bayt have with each other. It is a strange connection that these five particularly who were under the Kisa had to each other. Just think back to the days or the events that surrounded the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, such that when the whole Muslim Ummah knew of the tragedy that was about to befall them, the people were surrounding the bed of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, all of his family members, everyone who was close to him. The only people that he wanted near in those last moments were the people who were considered to be his blood, his nafs, his ruh. And that's why he would ask, ad'u li, akhi wa sahibi, call for me, my brother, my companion. And no one other than Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam did. And you saw the proximity, because why? Then Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salatu wassalam came in. Then even when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam was unconscious due to the sickness that eventually took his life, that his grandsons al-Hasan and al-Husayn, they came into the room. They were very young. They fell upon the body of their grandfather and they were holding on to him. And at that moment, Amir al-Mu'mineen, out of concern for Rasulullah, he said to Al-Imam al-Hasan and Imam al-Husayn, he says, my sons, move. Your grandfather is unwell. In this moment, move to the side a little, step to the side. They say, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he awoke or regained consciousness. And he turned to Amir al-Mu'mineen, seeing his two beloved grandsons clutching onto his body. He said, da'ahuma ya Ali, let them be ya Ali. Da'ahuma yashummani wa ashammuhuma. Allow them to smell my fragrance and I will smell their fragrance. Allow them, O Ali, to clutch onto me and allow me to clutch onto them. This sentiment that was between these five individuals, Ashab al-Kisa, is one that is absolutely unique. And they were the ones who had seen and been in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, because al-Imam Ali Zainul Abidin, the fourth Imam who came, he was born after the demise of Rasulullah from the life of this world. He came afterwards, much afterwards, decades afterwards. And so you see what was imprinted on the four individuals who were with Rasulullah was absolutely and totally unique. That's why when people ask that why is the tragedy of Karbala so big, so great, it is because it is explained that al-Imam al-Husayn was the last of Ashab al-Kisa. And when he died, it was a great and immeasurable tragedy and pain and sorrow on the Muslim Ummah, and particularly on the followers of the Ahl al-Bayt alayhim salatu wassalam. And now we see from the valor, the courage, the steadfastness of these five, the four who were with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam underneath the Kisa, and who had qualities that were unique, who had qualities that were unmatched. Those qualities, when you look at Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, you get an understanding for what sort of strength he had inside of him. Whether this is from the very beginning in the night of Hijrah, when he was lying on the bed of Rasulullah, whether he faced great peril on departing from Mecca with the three Fatimas, taking them towards Medina, following Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, whether this was fighting hand to hand in the battle of Badr, or facing the challenges and difficulties in Uhud and falling on the body of Rasulullah to shield him from the assault of the enemy soldiers, when others had run in all directions, scurrying and running away from the assault of Khalid ibn al-Walid, whether it was Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam standing up to fight against Umru ibn Abdu'ad or Marhab in Khaybar, how he stood and he took the pains on his body, such that his body had become riddled with injuries. Yet you notice one thing, that he never moved off of the goal and the path that he had in front of him. He never wavered. He was always focused on what he had to achieve and what was his duty. And that is the legacy that in this first few words of my majlis, I want to mention to remind myself and you that the path of Allah, the path of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam, is a path of unwavering resolve on the path of God. And doing so, knowing full well that you are walking a path where you are going to face trials, you are going to face tribulations, the dark waves will crash over your head, the wind will blow, people will come to push you, shove you, dissuade you, delude you, and try to trick you into moving away. And what you will do is you will look at the akhirah and you will look at your goal like Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam did. And that's why when we consider his legacy, we consider the one who fulfilled his covenant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is amazingly beautiful that when Hajj Aziz was reciting the surah, the very first ayah he mentioned was the Uhud, was the covenants that existed. And now the ayah that I related to you in the very beginning, it says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ. There are some people, Allah describes in this verse and in the very previous verse, He is describing those people who are considered to be fasiqeen. Fasiqeen are those people who transgress the boundaries of God and do so knowing full well that God has forbidden something and yet they still break it. They go away from what God has ordained. And in this verse now, Allah clarifies, who are these people? These are the people who have three qualities inside of them. One, يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ. They break the covenant that they have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after it has already been established. Number two, يَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلْ. They cut off the command of God such that they prevent it from being fulfilled on the earth. They strive whatever they can to block the command of God, the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth. وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And number three, they spread fasad throughout the earth. So let's look at these three things in this one verse. And let's reflect on Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam and what he did in his life. And in the same way, let us ask ourselves that these three things, breaking of the covenant to God, cutting off the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that we consciously are blocking what God wants to happen, what is God's plan, what is ordained by Allah, and number three, fasad in the earth. What is it that we have to ask ourselves in terms of these three things? Have we done any of these three things, God forbid? Are we guilty of it? And if so, what is the path of reformation and remediation for ourselves? The first aspect of this verse that the Quran talks about, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran, He says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alam a'had ilaykum ya bani adama an la ta'budu shaytan. Ahd is a covenant. It just means that you have vowed something, promised something to God. Now some will ask, well, how is that possible? For a ahd to occur, you must have two people. If I were to promise my good brother Hajj Karrar that I'm going to do something and I make a covenant with him, he has to be present with me and I have to be conscious of the fact that I'm making this covenant to him. He will hear me. I will say, Hajj Karrar, tomorrow I will do such and such. I consciously make that statement to him and he hears me and acknowledges that I have made that statement. Now, in the case of Allah, if Allah says, Alam ahad ilaykum ya bani adama an la ta'budu shaytan, we can say, Ya Allah, in what way did you make a ahd with us? In what way did you make a covenant with us? You were never present here in front of us physically that we saw you, that we consciously said to you, God, we promise and we make a testament to you. We make a covenant to you and that we should be held to that covenant. Well, the answer is that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created you with a fitrah. He created you with a basic nature that is inside of you. That basic nature, you cannot go against it. My dear brothers and sisters, your genes, the genetic code that is inside of you, what you are born with is what is you're going to be. There is no way to change that. You are a product of what your father and mother, the genes that have been placed inside of you by your mother and father. You cannot go in and replace them with some other gene. You cannot change that gene such that it becomes something other than a human being. You are what you are based on that fitrah, that nature that God has put inside of you. That nature, that very imprinted molecular aspect of you, my dear brothers and sisters, is what has automatically connected itself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such that every cell that sprouts in your body from that gene And every cell, brain cell, heart cell, blood cell, doesn't matter. It is a product of the gene that has become expressed in your body in some way, shape, or form, and divided and grown and such that you have become this fully functional human being. That gene reflects the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether you believe in it, whether you admit to it, or whether you attest to the oneness of Allah or not, your basic nature that has resulted in your existing in this world echoes the words of La ilaha illallah. And it is only you and your nafs and your whims that deny that. That is the ahd. And so when Allah created you and placed in you this, He placed it so intrinsically in you that you cannot escape it. You cannot be rid of it. You cannot tear it out of your body such that you say, well, I don't want it. It is a part of you. It is there. It will be with you until your last breath and you leave this world. That is the ahd. And that is the ahd that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, recognize that when I put a testament and made a covenant with you, you were to follow what I told you to follow. You are to do what I told you to do. You are to stay within the boundaries. And that's why in this very ayah, He says, أَلَمْ أَعْهَدْ إِلَيْكُمْ يَا بَنِي آدَمَ أَنْ لَا تَعْبُدُ الشَّيْطَانِ. I have made a covenant with you. Do not worship the shaitan, Ya Allah. Starts off by saying, don't worship the shaitan, the source of misguidance, the source of all of those things that will lead us astray. إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. He is a clear and manifest enemy to you. And instead, what should you do? وَنَعْبُدُونِي هَذَا صَرَاطٌ مُسْتَقِيمٌ. Instead, worship me, Allah says, because that is the straight path. That is Sirat al-Mustaqim. Follow me. My dear brothers and sisters, that ahd is important such that in any way, shape, or form, if we compromise what God tells us, even to the littlest dot, then we will have broken that ahd to some degree or violated its conditions upon us. That's why when you think about Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam, you see the one who in no way, shape, or form ever erred, ever made a mistake, ever transgressed. He remained. And you don't have to take my word for it. Just look at his actions. In the most critical of moments when other people were doing what they did, and see how he responded. And I will give you an example of that in just a few moments. The second thing that the verse talks about, it says, وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُوصَلَ. They stop and they cut off the command of God and they prevent it from it being enacted in the earth. The ulama, they explain about this verse and this portion in particular. They said, in particular, this is about قَطْعِ الرَّحْمِ. It is about breaking off with your family and that indeed you must not break off with your family. However, the ulama, they say, that its meaning goes beyond just cutting off with your family, which you should absolutely not do. It means cutting off from anything that God has ordained to be proper and correct. What does that mean? It means if God has said something is the truth, then you should do nothing to break that truth. You should do nothing to violate that truth. If God says something is a benefit to society, you should not go and do something that is opposite to that, to violate what God said was a benefit. If God says that something is considered to be just and proper and viable and equitable, you should not exercise your own limited judgment on it to say that it is not. And that's why, even when it comes to the laws of Islam, you see that many a things that we don't understand why the law is the way it is. That's why we have to accept what God's wisdom tells us is correct and follow in that. The last thing that the verse talks about is that these people are the ones who do fasad in the earth and spread it in such a way that it causes mischief everywhere. Fasad is just the ruination of everything. It's the ruination of something that has value. So you take something of value and you destroy its significance and its utility in society. That could be anything. My dear brothers and sisters, it could be the destruction of a field, a farm. It could be destroying the property of someone else. It could be lying. It could be cheating. It could be the fact that you have a good mind and you are using it for things that are haram or for hurting someone or assaulting someone, this is all a form of fasad. It is all a form of ruination. And that's why the Quran mentions this very, very clearly. And it is all tied to that shaitan. And that's why these three things in particular, Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam, our beloved Imam, what did he say? He said, Ala wa inna ash-shaytana qad jama'a hizbahu wastajlaba khaylahu wa rijlah. He says, don't you know that the shaitan has gathered his men and his supporters together, and he has prepared his rides, and he has prepared the means by which he is going to assault you. And then he says, wa inna ma'ya la basirati. He says, that is your case because you are prone to shaitan. As for me, Imam Ali, he says, I have my insight. I have my basira. I have this inside of me something that allows me to see through him, to see through shaitan and to know his scheming against me. He says, ma labbastu ala nafsi wala lubbisa alay. He says, there will never come a time when I put what is mine upon somebody else, nor that someone came and forcibly made me to wear something I did not wear. And he is not talking about clothing. He's talking about position. And that's why, even for us, I say all of this tonight to you, that maybe we reflect within our own selves what Quran and Amir al-Mu'mineen are telling us. He says, I did not wear what is mine onto someone else. And on my own self, I did not allow anyone to put something. I did not allow anyone to clothe me with their thoughts, their inclinations, and their goals and what they wanted to achieve of selfishness in this life. And that's why Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam was not always favored in the society after Rasulullah. In fact, I might say, and I think you all know, that they overlooked him. And if you look immediately at the moment when the second Khalifa was about to leave this world, and this is all just a matter of history, that when the second Khalifa was about to die, he organized a committee of men who were going to choose the next Khalifa. And they said, look, he said, look, I am advising you that there are a few men who you can choose from. One is Al-Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam, because nobody can deny his position with respect to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. The other is Uthman ibn Affan, who is one of the older companions and considered to be well-respected amongst the people. And there were a few other individuals who were there. One or two other individuals who may have been considered. And now he orders this committee to come and decide. Now, in that in itself posed a problem. Why? Because these people did not necessarily represent the Muslim Ummah. And because the way that they were comprised and those personalities who were sitting on that committee would have ensured that by no way, no means was Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam going to become the next Khalifa. Moreover, if the decision was left in the hands of the Muslims, should it not have been representative of all of those Muslims to hear their voice of who should be the rightful Khalifa? Now, look at who the people were who were chosen to be on this committee. One was Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas. Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas was a Umayyad. He was from the tribe of Banu Umayyah. And not only was he from the tribe of Banu Umayyah, but it is known that many of his relatives had been killed by Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam in the early battles of Islam. So Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, he is one of those individuals on the committee. Moreover, Sa'ad's mother is the daughter of Abu Sufyan. Imagine, she is the sister of Muawiyah. So he is one of those people. The second is Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awam. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awam, you all know what his position was. Later on, particularly when it came to the Battle of Jamal and where he stood with his allegiances. The third person was Talha ibn Ubaidullah. Talha ibn Ubaidullah, he was from the tribe of Taym. He was from the same tribe as the first Khalifa. So you can imagine now what his position is going to be. The fourth person, Uthman ibn Affan, you know, he is of the tribe, same tribe as the Banu Umayyah. And the fifth person is Abd al-Rahman ibn al-Awf. Abd al-Rahman ibn Awf was actually the son-in-law of Uthman. He was married to the daughter of Uthman. So now I ask you, with these names and these members who are sitting there, deciding on who is going to be the next Khalifa, how is it, do you think, that there is going to be any preference that is going to be given to Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam in any way, shape, or form? It will never happen. Why? Because they are not representative of those people. Where is Salman al-Farisi? Where is Aba Dhar al-Ghifari? Where is Miqdad? Where are all of these Ammar ibn Yasir, Malik al-Ashtar, all of these individuals? None of them have been considered. Bilal ibn Rabbah, the muadhin of the community, been there since the first days in Mecca. He has been with Rasulullah. He is not there. He is not considered. So you understand what that position is. And now the years go by. And even with all of this, Amir al-Mu'mineen stays. And stays because he knows there is challenge coming. And he assumes the Khilafah, I already mentioned to you in the last few nights. And he comes and he relates to the people something that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says. He says, any ruler who will come to rule over the Muslims after me, any ruler who will come to rule over the Muslims after me will be on the edge of a bridge that sits in the middle between paradise and hell. Ya Allah. Any ruler who comes to rule over the Muslims after me will be sitting on the edge between hell and heaven, Jahannam and Jannah. And the angels will be sitting there waiting to record his deeds with all focus and all detail. He says, if he is proved fair, Al-Imam Ali alayhi salam, he quotes Rasulullah, if he turns out to be fair, Allah will save him due to his justice. And if he is turned to be a zalim, he is unjust, then that bridge that he is standing on will shake under his feet until his limbs will be separated and he will fall into the hellfire and he will be consumed by that fire. My dear brothers and sisters, Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, Rasulullah, my Habib Rasulullah has said that the first person of holding a position of authority, is blame. The second is regret. And the third is chastisement. Everyone seeks that authority, but they don't realize the responsibility of it. And once you've gotten it, then you know, because then you will blame yourself. Why did I take it? You will regret that you took it, and you will face the consequences on the day of judgment. Amir al-Mu'mineen knew these things before anything had even happened. He understood the consequences. He understood. And that's why when he faced what he faced afterwards, and now going back to that ayah that I recited for you, that there are those who will come and they will break their covenants with God. They will cut off the command of Allah from being ordained in the earth, coming to pass in the earth, and they will do fasad in the earth. It is reported that one day, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he says, one day he relates himself, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he ordered us that after he is gone, that we should fight three groups of people. Al-Nakithin, Al-Qasitin, Wal-Mariqin. These three groups of people you have to fight against, Rasulullah told Abu Sa'id. Abu Sa'id, he says, we asked Rasulullah that, Ya Rasulullah, who are these people? And how is it that we are to fight them? Who should we fight them with? How will we know who is the leader for us? They say, Rasulullah, he says, Ma'a Ali ibn Abi Talib. Stand with Ali to fight against these people. Who are these people? The Nakithin, my dear brothers and sisters, are the pledge breakers. People who have made a pledge and a covenant, and they break that pledge and that covenant. Remember the ayah that I read to you. They break that covenant. Number two, Al-Qasitin. Qasitin, these are the people who are the wrongdoers. What do? They break what God has said and they spread fasad everywhere. And the Mariqin. The Mariqin are those people who are the apostates, meaning they have turned away from God, what God has ordered. They have decided that what they think of religion is right and what God ordained, they don't know about it, they don't understand, and they have chosen only what they interpret in that religion. That's why when you see what happened in the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen after he assumed the worldly khilafah, you understand why he stood up against these groups of people. And you further appreciate what he was doing from the perspective of upholding the Holy Quran and its true ethos, its true meaning. And that's why when he got to Basra, when he was heading towards Basra, in the days when the army of the camel were about to ride out from Basra to meet him, they say Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam, he came out of Basra and he stopped in a place known as Az-Zawiya. In Az-Zawiya, he stops there. And with his men, he leads a congregational prayer. He does Salat al-Jama'ah. And as he's sitting there, the Rawi describes, they have not yet met the army of the Jamal, of the camel, but he is sitting there. He is finishing his prayers. And now after the prayers, he is supplicating. And the Rawi describes that Amir al-Mu'mineen is weeping profusely. Tears are running down his cheeks. And he is beseeching God. What is it, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? Why are you crying and weeping in this moment? Amir al-Mu'mineen is praying to Allah that, Ya Allah, spare the Muslims shedding their own blood. Spare the Muslims from killing each other and shedding their own blood. Guard them, Ya Allah, against the misfortunes of war, and bring them together, Ya Allah, and make them united in truth and in the true guidance, Ya Allah. That battle of Jamal, I described some of it already to you. You know, opened up great challenges. Why? Because these were the people who broke the pledge. Now I ask you that when some of these Muslims see that it is okay to go and ride out against Amir al-Mu'mineen, they see that it is acceptable to ride out against the person who is the Imam ordained by God, but even the people have ordained him or chosen him to be the Khalifa, it emboldens others to do what? To break their covenant, to make sure that whatever they have attested to, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna muhammadan rasulullah, that its meaning is very trivial and that very easily it can be sidestepped to choose something else. And in fact, you see this, that the person most emboldened, most given courage to step forward and cause trouble and spread fasad through the earth was who? It was Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, who now at the end will not stop. He will continue to trouble Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wassalam. He will create fasad, and that too, either doing it himself by ordering people to curse Imam Ali from the pulpit, spreading propaganda and misinformation about Amir al-Mu'mineen, or calling a man like Amr ibn al-As to go in and to use trickery to deceive the appointed person from the side of Amir al-Mu'mineen after the Battle of Siffin is stopped and there is an armistice. And you see that the result of that was even worse now, that what happened at Jamal created disorder and emboldened the enemies of Islam, but now Siffin created a new faction. Imagine, from Siffin, you get a faction of people who now feign religiosity, think that they are religious, and yet instead are moving away from the religion of God. These are the Khawarij. And these are the people who are cutting what God has ordered. It is described that even the Khawarij, that when they formed, Imam Ali at first left them be. He said, okay, you don't want to accept me. You want to hurl insults at me. You know that Amir al-Mu'mineen will sit in his mihrab to pray, or he will be leading the Salat al-Jama'ah. And what will happen? The Khawarij will be sitting behind him, heckling him, quoting and misinterpreting ayahs of the Quran, calling him a kafir, wal-ayadu billah, giving him trouble by talking nasty things to him. Amir al-Mu'mineen left them be, because this had no harm. He said, let them say what they want about me. Let them call me names. Let them say whatever. As long as they are not creating any fasad in the earth, let them be. However, what did they do? They say that they moved to a place called Al-Jazeera. Al-Jazeera is an area in what is now Syria today. It is what is called the city of Raqqa. It is strange how the history goes. And in the city of Raqqa, they set up a home base of sorts. And anyone who will come through this area, they will stop them and they will ask them, what do you think about Ali ibn Abi Talib? They say a man, in the history it is recited, that a man named Abdullah ibn Khabbab ibn Arad, he was passing through this city called Al-Jazira, what is Raqqa today. The Khawarij, they stopped him. With this man was his pregnant wife. They asked him, they said, look, tell us about Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. What do you know about him? This man, Abdullah ibn Khabbab, he says, this is the champion of Rasulullah. He is the one who slept in the bed of Rasulullah. He is the one who is known as Amir al-Mu'mineen. He is the Khalifa, etc. He says what everyone knows. And this man was not even a supporter of Amir al-Mu'mineen. They say that those Khawarij captured this man, Abdullah ibn Khabbab. They executed him, and not only executed him, but they killed his pregnant wife and the unborn child in her womb. This was now the facade that was spreading in the earth. And now it comes to Amir al-Mu'mineen. And Amir al-Mu'mineen now knows that no longer is it possible to just leave them be, because these are now no longer just hecklers sitting behind him in the Masjid of Kufa or Masjid of Medina or wherever he's leading the prayers. But these are people who are spilling the blood of Muslims and creating fasad in the earth. And that's why Amir al-Mu'mineen, he comes out. And when he comes out, he deals with them, vanquishes them. And not only are many of them vanquished in the battle of Nahrawan, but after it is over, Amir al-Mu'mineen, you all know, he says to his followers, his close companions, that do not fight them anymore, because the head of the snake has been killed. They are no longer organized. Let them be vanquished. Let them live in peace, but do not fight them anymore. Amir al-Mu'mineen knew how to deal with these conditions, and he knew how to deal with them. However, you all know that the plotting continued. And in fact, you all know that one man, Abdurrahman ibn Muljim. Abdurrahman ibn Muljim, I don't know how many of you know this, but he was a Quran teacher. Ya Allah, he was a teacher of the Quran. And not only was he a teacher of the Quran, he was well known for it. And what ended up happening is that he came upon a company of people, amongst whom there was a lady, her name was Qatam. Qatam al-Taymiyyah. Qatam was a very beautiful woman, and Ibn Muljim wanted to marry her. She said to him, look, I will marry you, but the mahar that you must give me is such and such amount of money. You must give me a certain amount of animals or some other things, she stipulated. And she said, you must kill Ali ibn Abi Talib. Then I will marry you. I will be your wife. Why? Because she had lost relatives at the hands of Amir al-Mu'mineen in those battles. And you know that the plotting continued, not just against Amir al-Mu'mineen, but against other individuals as well, even targets against Muawiyah. They say the targets, when they came to target Muawiyah, that Muawiyah, instead of coming out on his normal path to go to the mosque to lead the prayers up in Syria, that he had just not gone. And in fact, his bodyguards were able to save him from the assault. The other man was Amr ibn al-As, and he, instead of going to lead the prayers, had sent somebody else wearing his cloak. That poor man got shot with an arrow or was attacked, and he was killed and assassinated. Now this remains for Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib. And my dear brothers and sisters, I remind myself and I remind you in this moment that let us be of those who live by our covenant to Allah, and realize that when you live by your covenant for God, it is going to be difficult. It is not going to be easy. It is not going to be a life of ease. You will face challenges. You will face roadblocks. And the world will constantly try to move you off of your covenant, always. And number two, let us ensure that we do not block the command of God. Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu alayhi min dhalik. May God save us from something like that. That if God has ordained something, let us not be the ones who in any way, shape, or form, whether directly or indirectly, stop the fulfillment of God's command, what God has meant to pass in the earth. And number three, let us not create facade. Let us not be of those people who ruin what is valuable. And that all of it requires us to live a life like Amir al-Mu'mineen, a life in which you know that you shed yourself from the world. You shed yourself from anything that can draw your love away from Allah. And that is the key. You take everything away. And that's why even when his children sat on his lap, when Sayyida Zainab sat on his lap, Aba al-Fadl al-Abbas was near, and they said, Ya Aba, do you love us? Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, I love all my children. Sayyida Zainab, it is reported, she said to him, My father, how can you love more than one thing when you have only one heart inside your heart, inside your chest? Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, I love all of you because of my love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have only one love in my heart, and that is the love of God. And because of that love of God, I love my children. I love my sons and my daughters and everyone who is near to me. This is the legacy of those who gave for the sake of Allah and had love for nothing other than Allah. That's why they stood on that path and did not fall off of it. You all know that on those nights, the nights when he was struck, and after his burial even, that in the darkness of the night, and I relay this to you every time, every year, I relay the same thing to you. And I say it this year, that there are so many people in the world whose cries are going unheard. There are so many people in the world who are appealing for help, and it is falling on deaf ears. Let us not be of those people whose ears are closed. Let us not be of those people who ignore the plea of somebody else. Because on that night, in the middle of the night, in the darkness, when Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn had buried Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, and I don't know if you know this, but that when he was buried in secrecy. People did not know the grave of Ali ibn Abi Talib until decades later. Decades later, they did not know where he was buried. And that's why many were not aware of what had happened. And so when they have buried him and they are walking in the streets when everyone is asleep, and the cry is coming from the poor man, the beggar who is sitting in the corner. And they go to him, they see him weeping and wailing, in pain, suffering. They say to him, what has happened? He says that I am so poor and destitute and hungry. And it so happens that generous man, the compassionate and merciful man who used to come to me in the darkness of the night, when everyone was asleep and oblivious of my pain and suffering, he would give me food. He would take care of me. He would console me. He has not come. 2 days have gone by and he has not come. He has disappeared. Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, they asked, they said, describe him. Who was he? Who was this man? The man, he says, I cannot describe other than what the features were of his face. He describes, they said, don't you know that this was our father Ali ibn Abi Talib? And that not long ago, he has left the world. Wa thakala, wa aliyah. That the world has lost someone like Ali. And we feel that loss today. My dear brothers and sisters, Amir al-Mu'mineen, lying in Masjid al-Kufa on that morning of the 19th of the month of Ramadan, they say the blood has seeped from the head and drenched his beard. And the people who were there in the mosque, they have come and they have captured Ibn Muljim, tied his hands very tightly with the ropes and have pushed him forward and brought him to where Amir al-Mu'mineen is lying. Amir al-Mu'mineen, going in and out of consciousness, he looks at his son. He says, Ya Bunay, Ya Waladi, Ya Hassan, Irfaq bi asirik, warhamhu wahsin ilayh, washfaq alayh. O my son, Ya Hassan, be compassionate and be generous and do good to your captive, the one who you have been, who has been brought here as a prisoner. Be kind to him. Ala tara ala tara anna aynahu qad tarata fi umm ra'sih. Can you not see that his eyes are shaking, that the fear is visible in his eyes? Wa qalbuhu yarjufu khawfan wa ru'ba. Can you not see that his heart is quaking, that he is tremoring and trembling with fear? Al-Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam looked at his father and he began to weep, seeing his father's position. And then finally, he says, Amir al-Mu'mineen, looking at Ibn Muljim, he says, Ya Ya Ibn Muljim, قد جئت أمرا عظيما وخطبا جسيما. O Ibn Muljim, you have caused a calamitous affair. What you have done, أبئس الإمام كنت لك حتى جازيتني بهذا الجزاء. Was I such a terrible imam to you that you had to repay me in this manner? ألم أكن شفيقا لك وعليك وآثرتك على غيرك. Was I not kind to you? Did I not show you preference over others, show kindness and tolerance to you? My dear brothers and sisters, the ropes were loosened from the hands of this criminal. He was treated with compassion and mercy, like Amir al-Mu'mineen had ordered and asked of his son al-Hasan. Now the time had come for them to carry Amir al-Mu'mineen back to his home. فَحَمَلُوهُ عَلَىٰ أَكْتَافِهِمْ, they carried him on their shoulders, bringing him slowly out of the mosque, moving towards the home. As they are moving towards the home of Amir al-Mu'mineen, they say, in the weakness of his strike, now the body suffering from the wound and the poison that is spreading. Amir al-Mu'mineen, in a quiet voice, he says to them, Enziluni, Enziluni. Put me down to the ground. Put me down on the ground. They put him down on the ground, right there on the way to his home. Al-Hasan, he comes to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says to him, Ya Abba, we have to take you to the home. Why have you asked us to leave you here and put you down on the ground? He says to him, Ya Bunayya Hassan, Inni ara sawatan ala babil bayt, I can see someone is standing on the door of my house, dressed all in black, waiting for me. La'allaha binti Zainab, maybe it is Zainab who is waiting. Zainab is waiting at the door of the house for her father to come. Finally, they lift up Amir al-Mu'mineen, bring him to the house. 2 days he remains in this state. Everyone is bewildered in the city. Everyone has surrounded the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Brothers and sisters, finally Al-Hasan, he tells the people, get up and start going back to your homes. He comes to the door. He sees in front of the door, some children have lined up, gathered at the door of Aba al-Aytam, Amir al-Mu'mineen. Little orphans of the city, all have gathered at the door of their father's house, at the door of Ali ibn Abi Talib's house. Some of them, the Rawi says, carrying bowls of yogurt. when someone asked them, why are you bringing yogurt to the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen? They said, we heard that yogurt will cure the sickness of our father Ali. Yogurt will take away the ailment that has afflicted him. All are asked to leave from the home. Al-Hasan, he comes to the door. After everyone has departed, he sees one person standing there, not leaving from the door of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He looks at him, he says, oh, Asbal, did you not hear my request for everyone to go back to their homes? Al-Asbagh ibn Nubata, he says, my master, ibn Rasulillah, I cannot leave the door of Ali. My legs won't carry me away from the door of Ali. We say with the same voice as Asbagh, our legs will not take us away from the door of Ali. Our hearts will not take us away from the door of Ali. Asbagh ibn Nubata, he says, Ya ibn Rasulillah, allow me to see my master one time. They let him in. Al-Asbagh ibn Nubata comes into the room with Mawlana Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says, I saw my master lying on the bed. He had wrapped a yellow band around his head. But the sickness from the poison, the strike on his head, had turned the color of his skin yellow. I could not tell which had more yellow color, the band on his head or the color of his skin. Al-Asbagh waqa'a ala jasadi Amir al-Mu'mineen wa bada'a yabki. Asbagh fell on the body of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He began to weep and cry. Amir al-Mu'mineen opened his eyes. He says, La tabki ya Asbagh, fa innaha al-Jannah. Oh Asbagh, do not cry. Jannah is waiting for me. Asbagh wiped away the tears from his eyes. He says, Sayyidi ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, ja'altu fidak, inni a'lamu wallah, annaka qadimun ila al-Jannah. Oh my master ya Ali, I know that you are certainly going towards Jannah. I am not crying for that. Walakin abki li faqdani iyyak. I am crying because I am losing you, my master, ya Ali. In those last moments, only the family were around him. And they stood by the body of Al-Imam Ali, Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn, Zainab and Umm Kulthum, Aba al-Fadl al-Abbas, the brothers of al-Abbas, Muhammad al-Hanafiyya, all the children of Amir al-Mu'mineen, surrounding them. When finally Zainab al-Kubra, she said, Wa Abata, Wa Aliya, Men lis-sighari ba'dak ya Aba, who will take care of the children after you are gone? Man lil yatama wal aramili ya Aba, who is going to take care of the widows and the orphans once you are gone, my father? The pain of losing you has wounded our hearts. Al-Imam Ali, he opened his eyes. He looked at all of them gathered. He said to them in his voice, he said, Hada Rasulullah wa ammi Hamza. Rasulullah has come. My uncle Hamza is here. Wa akhi Ja'far
وأصحاب رسول الله. My brother Ja'far has come. The companions of Rasulullah who were martyred have come. وكلهم يقولون عجل قدومك علينا يا علي. Come to us soon, ya Ali. Be reunited with us, ya Ali. ثم أدار عينيه في أهل بيته. He turned his face and looked at each one of his children. He said to them, استودعكم الله جميعا, سددكم الله جميعا. May Allah keep you strong. In Allah's care I leave you. حفظكم الله جميعا. May Allah protect you. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Bearing the final witness and the testament. ثم قضى نحبه وفارق الدنيا ولعنة الله على قاتله. The soul left the body. He departed from this world. May the curse of Allah be on his killer. And now the only sounds that are coming are the cries of Banat Rasulullah saying, Wah Aliya, Wah Mabluma, Wah Thakala. وسأعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك ونقسم عليك بحق الزهراء وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها سر المستودع فيها لعن الله ظالميها. اللهم شافي كل مريض. اللهم رد كل غريب. اللهم فك كل أسير. اللهم غير سوحالنا بحسن حالك يا كريم. اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك وجنبنا معاصيك وثبت أقدامنا على صراطك المستقيم. وثبت أقدامنا على صراطك المستقيم. وخذ بأيدينا إليك يا أرحم الراحمين. وفرج عنا يا الله فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر أو هو أقرب من ذلك. وافرغ علينا صبرا وتوفنا مسلمين. والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. يا علي
يا علي يا علي
يا علي
يا علي,
يا علي. علی امشب چرا بحر عبادت بر نمی خیزد. علی امشب چرا بحر عبادت بر نمی خیزد. چرا شیر خدا از بحر طاعت بر نمی خیزد. خدا جویی که از یاد خدا یک دم نشد غافل. خدا جویی که از یاد خدا یک دم نشد غافل. چه رخ داده که از بحر عبادت بر نمی خیزد. علی امشب چرا بهر عبادت بر نمی خیزد چرا شیر خدا از بهر طاعت بر نمی خیزد از آن ضربت که بر فرق علی زد زاده ملجم از آن ضربت که بر فرق علی زد زاده ملجم یقین دارم که از جا تا قیامت بر نمی خیزد علی امشب چرا بهر عبادت بر نمی خیزد چرا شیر خدا از بهر طاعت بر نمی خیزد به محراب دعا در خون شناور گشت شیر حق به محراب دعا در خون شناور گشت شیر حق دیگر بهر دعا ان ابر رحمت بر نمی خیزد علی امشب چرا بهر عبادت بر نمی خیزد چرا شیر خدا از بهر طاعت بر نمی خیزد طبیب زخم سرش را دید و گفته با حسرت طبیب زخم سرش را دید و گفته با حسرت علی دیگر از این بستر سلامت بر نمی خیزد علی امشب چرا بهر عبادت بر نمی خیزد چرا شیر خدا از بهر طاعت بر نمی خیزد یا علی یا علی
یا علی یا علی یا علی یا علی جزاک اللہ برادر حکمت توجہ زیارت
اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم السلام علیکم یا رسول اللہ السلام علیکم یا نبی اللہ السلام علیکم یا امیر المؤمنین امام المتقین علی ابن ابی طالب السلام علیکم یا فاطمہ الزہرا سیدۃ نساء العالمین ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ السلام علیکم یا ابا محمد الحسن المجتبى السلام علیکم یا الشہید بن ذکر بلا امام حسین ابن علی ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ السلام علیکم یا علی ابن الحسین ومحمد ابن علی وجعفر ابن محمد وموسی ابن جعفر وعلی ابن موسی ومحمد ابن علی وعلی ابن محمد والحسن ابن علی السلام علیکم یا صاحب الاسم والزمان الامان 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 السلام علیکم یا شریک القرآن السلام علیکم یا مظهر الایمان السلام علیکم یا خلیفۃ الرحمن والسلام علیکم یا امام الانس والجان اجل الله تعالی فرجک وسهل الله مخرجک وظهورک ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ
اللهم صل علی محمد وعلی محمد Jazak Allah, brothers and sisters, for joining us and remember us in this blessed night in your prayers in the Laylatul Qadr and ask for the forgiveness of all our sins, inshallah, by the haqq of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And inshallah, will be tomorrow for the Shahadat. The majlis will be at 7 o'clock before the Maghrib. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.